gather now for the service of Good Friday. This service is one in which we remember that after Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples and then his arrest, he took that journey to the cross where he died for the rescue of his people, died in rescue of us. We invite you to enter into this time of contemplation. During the service, there will be some singing that will be a part of a taizé style of singing. You're invited to listen and then sing if you are able, and then we will also be listening to scripture. The scripture that we take tonight will come all from Matthew's gospel and the way he saw this time from the time of the Last Supper on through Jesus' crucifixion and death on the cross. Let us enter now into this time of worship.
Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O Lord, are holy. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. Alleluia. Come and fill our hearts with your peace. You alone, O Lord, are holy. Come and fill our
reminded now of the night of Jesus' arrest. Matthew 26, 31 through 56, let us listen for the word of the Lord. Then Jesus said to them, "You will all become deserters because of me this night. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd and the sheep of the flock will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Though all become deserters because of you, I will never desert you." Jesus said to him, "Truly I tell you, this very night before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. Then Jesus went with them to the place called Gethsemane. And he said to his disciples, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee and began to be grieved and agitated. Then he said to them, "I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and stay awake with me." Going a little farther, he threw himself on the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, let this cup pass from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want." Then he came to the disciples and he found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, "So could you not stay awake with me an hour? Stay awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit is indeed willing, but the flesh is weak." Again, Jesus went away, and for a second time he prayed, "My Father, if this cannot pass unless I drink it, your will be done." Again, he came and found them sleeping, for their eyes were heavy. So leaving them again, he went away and prayed for a third time, saying the same words. Then he came to the disciples and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? See, the hour is at hand. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand. While Jesus was speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived with him, a large crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests and the elders of the people. Now the betrayer had given them a sign saying, "The one I kiss, this is the man. Arrest him." At once he came up to Jesus and said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and he kissed him. Jesus said to him, "Friend, do what you are here to do." Then he came and he laid his hands on Jesus, and they arrested him. Suddenly one of those with Jesus put his hand on his sword, drew it, and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. And Jesus said to him, "Put your sword back in its place, for all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Do you think that I cannot appeal to my Father, and he will at once send me more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scripture be fulfilled, which say it must happen this way?" At that hour, Jesus said to the crowds, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I sat in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But all this has taken place so that the scripture of the prophets may be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled.
Stay with me, remain here with me, watch and pray, watch and pray. Of Jesus' trial and Peter's denial, Matthew 26, 57 through 75. Those who had arrested Jesus took him to Caiaphas, the high priest, in whose house the scribes and the elders had gathered. But Peter was following him at a distance, as far as the courtyard of the high priest. And going inside, he sat with the guards in order to see how this would end. Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for false testimony against Jesus so that they might put him to death. But they found none, though many false witnesses came forward. At last, two came forward and said, "This fellow said, 'I am able to destroy the temple of God and rebuild it in 3 days.'" The high priest stood up and said, "Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?" But Jesus was silent. Then the high priest said to him, "I put you under oath before the living God. Tell us if you are the Messiah, the Son of God." Jesus said to him, "You have said so. But I tell you, from now on, you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming on the clouds of heaven." Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, "He has blasphemed. Why do we still need witnesses? You have now heard his blasphemy. What is your verdict?" They answered, "He deserves death." They spat in his face and struck him, and some slapped him, saying, "Prophesy to us, you Messiah. Who is it that struck you?" Now Peter was sitting outside in the courtyard. A servant girl came to him and said, "You also were with Jesus the Galilean." But he denied it before all of them, saying, "I do not know what you are talking about." When he went out to the porch, another servant girl saw him, and she said to the bystanders, "This man was with Jesus of Nazareth." Again, he denied it with an oath, "I do not know the man." After a little while, the bystanders came up and said to Peter, "Certainly you are also one of them, for your accent betrays you." Then he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know the man." At that moment, the cock crowed. Then Peter remembered what Jesus has said, "Before the cock crows, you will deny me three times." And he went out and wept bitterly.
Stay with us, O Lord Jesus Christ. Night now has come. Then stay with us, O Lord Jesus Christ. Light in our darkness. Stay with us, O Lord Jesus Christ. Night now has come.
We are reminded of Jesus before Pilate and the fate of Judas. When morning came, all the chief priests and the elders of the people conferred together against Jesus in order to bring him to death. They bound him, and they led him away and handed him over to Pilate, the governor. When Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he repented and brought back the 30 pieces of silver the chief priests and the elders had given him. He said, "I have sinned by betraying innocent blood." But they said, "What is that to us? See to it yourself." Throwing down the pieces of silver in the temple, Judas departed, and he went and he hanged himself. The chief priests, taking the pieces of silver, said, "It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since they are blood money." After conferring together, they used them to buy the potter's field as a place to bury foreigners. For this reason, that field has been called the field of blood to this day. Then was fulfilled what had been spoken through the prophet Jeremiah. And they took the 30 pieces of silver, the pieces of the one on whom the price was, had been set, on whom some of the people of Israel had set a price, and they gave them for the potter's field, as the Lord had commanded them. Now Jesus, stood before the governor. And the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You say so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he did not answer. Then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many accusations they make against you?" But he gave him no answer, even to a single charge, so that the governor was amazed. But at the festival, the governor was accustomed to release a prisoner for the crowd, anyone whom they wanted. At that time, they had a notorious prisoner called Jesus Barabbas. So after they had gathered, Peter said to them, "Whom do you want me to release to you, Jesus Barabbas or Jesus who is called the Messiah?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that they handed him over. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that innocent man, for today I have suffered a great deal because of a dream about him." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus killed. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate answered them, "Then what should I do with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" All of them said, "Let him be crucified." And he asked, "Why? What evil has he done?" But they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So Pilate saw that he could do nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning. He took some water and he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." Then the people as a whole answered, "His blood will be on us and on our children." So Pilate released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, handed him over to be crucified.
My soul is at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from God. My soul is at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from God. My soul is at rest in God alone. My salvation comes from God.
We are reminded of Jesus' crucifixion. Matthew 27, 27 through 44. Then the soldiers of the governor took Jesus into the governor's headquarters, and they gathered the whole cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on his head. They put a reed in his right hand and knelt before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They spat on him and took the reed and struck him on the head. After mocking him, they stripped him of the robe and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him away to crucify him. As they went out, they came upon a man from Cyrene named Simon. They compelled this man to carry his cross. And when they came to a place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull, they offered him wine to drink, mixed with gall. But when he tasted it, he would not drink it. And when they had crucified him, they divided his clothes among themselves by casting lots. Then they sat down there and kept watch over him. Over his head, they put the charge against him, which read, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two bandits were crucified with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests also, along with the scribes and elders, were mocking him, saying, "He saved others. He cannot save himself. He's the King of Israel. Let him come down from the cross now, and we will believe in him. He trusts in God. Let God deliver him now if he wants to, for he said, 'I am God's son.'" The bandits who were crucified with him also taunted him in the same way.
We are reminded now of Jesus' death, Matthew 27, 45 through 54. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until it was 3 in the afternoon. And about 3 o'clock, Jesus cried with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, "My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And some of the bystanders heard it. They said, "This man is calling for Elijah." At once, one of them ran and got a sponge and filled it full of sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink. But the others said, "Wait, wait. Let us see whether Elijah will come and save him." Then Jesus cried again with a loud voice. He breathed his last. At that moment, the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. The earth shook and rocks were split. The tombs also were opened, and many bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. After his resurrection, they came out of the tombs and entered the holy city and appeared to many. Now there was a centurion and those with him who were keeping watch over Jesus. When they saw the earthquake and what took place, they were terrified, and they said, "Truly, this man was the Son of God.
Reminded of the words of the prophet as we remember Jesus, Isaiah 53. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. And as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have all turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors.
Let us pray. God, on this day, perhaps more than any other day, we recognize the love that you have for us that has been poured out in Jesus Christ. It is difficult for us to imagine the gift that you gave us, that you would bring us new life through the forgiveness of our sins. And so we take this day and we pause and we recognize the extent of your love. And we ask that throughout this day and through the full day tomorrow, when we remember the pain that the first disciples would have felt at your loss, we ask that you would allow us to return again, knowing that this is not the end of your story, and yet this is perhaps the crescendo of your love for us. Continue to be with us in this time. Continue to be with us as we walk through a difficult valley, and allow us to have hope in what lay on the other side. All these things we pray in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. So now be in peace, and may God be with you as you go.